Thank you so much, Ruth and Kathy, for a beautiful prelude. Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Christ of the Hills United Methodist Church. So glad that you are here today. We have several guests with us as well, and we're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us at Christ of the Hills today. We want everyone, members and guests alike, to register your attendance there on that pad and pass it down. Most will have already done that, but if you haven't yet, please do so, so we can have a good record of your being with us here at Christ of the Hills. Now, a couple of very special things that I have. One is, I want to recognize a very, very special person. She has been a volunteer assistant treasurer for Christ of the Hills for 12 years, back in 2005 to 2017. She paid bills, prepared payroll, prepared taxes. She came back as a staff member in 2019 to work with Delma Jensen and then took over the position in 2022 when Delma retired. So we have a certificate that we want to award her, to give her as a certificate of appreciation, presented to Jeannie Nelson for 15 years of commitment and service to Christ of the Hills United Methodist Church as she retires. Jeannie, would you come up here and let me embarrass you a little bit? Obviously, also a longtime choir member of our chancel choir, and we appreciate so much your service to Christ in Christ of the Hills United Methodist Church. So thank you so much for all you've done for this amazing church, and you've helped make it even more amazing for everyone who comes through these doors. Thank you so much. And one more thing, we're going to be saying goodbye today to a very, very special person who's been a member of Christ of the Hills United Methodist Church for 32 years and just turned 101 years old. So she joined the church 32 years ago when she was my age at 69. And we're talking about Gail Gilbert, and she'll be going to, and Gail, would you stand? Everyone, turn around. Yes, see Gail. Folks, many of you have joined the church since COVID. But prior to COVID, the way we did Holy Communion was a little bit different. And Gail prepared Holy Communion every month for 30 years. And how amazing that today will be her last Sunday, which is World Communion Sunday. So we're going to be saying goodbye to Gail on a very appropriate day that's yet sad for us because she is so much an integral part of this church. And Gail, we're going to have a prayer for you now, okay? Our God, we thank you for Gail Gilbert. We thank you for the service to Christ that she has been in this congregation for all these years, preparing the bread and the wine, so that we can partake of the feast of the gospel grace in the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Be with Gail now as she enters a new part of her life with family and as she leaves Hot Springs Village. We just lift her up and pray for her and all of her family in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
God bless you, Gail. All right, take your order of worship now, and as you're able, please stand and join me in the call to worship. This is inspired by the 133rd Psalm. How good and pleasant it is
when kindred live together in unity.
Such kinship is as if the refreshing dew of Mount Hermon in the north
were reaching even to the slopes of Mount Zion in the south.
For from there the Lord commanded his blessing.
Yes, from Jerusalem will flow life, life forevermore.
Now take your hymnals and turn to 545. We'll sing the first, second, and fifth stanzas of the church's one foundation.
Church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and one holy food, and to one hope she presses every grace endued. Yet she on earth hath union with God the three in one, and mystic sweet communion with those whose rest is won. Oh, happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with thee.
Let's affirm our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father.
Please be seated. Well, we celebrate this morning with our altar flowers. They are given to the glory of God by Neil and Karen Vineyard in celebration of their 59th wedding anniversary, and by Christ of the Hills on the retirement of staff member Jeannie Nelson. The flowers in the Welcome Center are given to the glory of God by Pamela Williams in loving memory of her mother, Helen Treadway, and brother Marvin Craig Treadway III. We extend our sympathy to COH member Deidre Auville on the death of her husband, Ron, and ask that we continue to remember that family. We have others listed here that we want to continue to pray for. And as always, if you have joys and concerns you want to share, please let us know and we'll be glad to share those with the congregation. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Most holy God, we're thankful to have this time with you, and we pray for your Spirit to be with us as we hear your word in ways that will sustain us through the week. We pray to be good soil and that the seeds of your word will take root in us so that it will grow and produce a great harvest of love. Help us continue to work together as we see the needs of others and give us courage and strength to meet their needs with the love that you give to us. God, we pray that your comfort will surround the people we've named this morning and continue to help them heal. We know that you feel the pain of your children, and you know exactly what to do for each of us. Help us share words of comfort and show acts of love to our sisters and brothers who are ill, hurting, and grieving. May they continue to feel your presence and be assured of your love for them. As we celebrate World Communion Sunday today, we're thankful to join others in our nation and around the world who are celebrating. What a joy and a blessing it is to come together in unity and remember the beautiful gift of salvation given to us by our Lord Jesus Christ. May we never forget this most precious gift, and may we always be thankful for the relationship that we have with Him. It is in His name that we pray. Amen.
God is good, isn't he?
All the time.
Oh, man. Thank you, Daryl. Appreciate it. We'll work on it. It's okay. It's okay. Our scripture passage for this morning comes out of the 17th chapter of the Gospel of John. We're going to read verses 1 through 6, 9 through 11, and verse 20 through 23a. In honor and praise for our gospel reading, would you please stand as you are able? After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have been given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but They are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, and they may become completely one. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please bow for our offertory prayer this morning. Almighty Father, our hearts overflow with thanksgiving and praise to you this morning. You are infinitely good to us. Your creation is so magnificent and incredible. It gives us pleasure and supplies all our needs for food and water and light and warmth. And you have supplied salvation and eternal life through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You supply our spiritual needs through communion with you, through our spiritual armor, our spiritual gifts, and through your indwelling Holy Spirit. Accept these tithes and offerings we bring to you today, and may you bless them as well as all the ministries of our church, that they might have eternal significance for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated.
Please be seated. And you see in the order of worship that my text is just a smaller portion of what Pastor Steve read a moment ago from John 17. I've given you a note here that this is very often called the high priestly prayer of Jesus. Jesus is finishing the work that God gave him to do. He's about to go to the cross. And this is his high priestly prayer when he says, I finished the work that you've given me to do. And then he's praying for the protection and for the eternal salvation of those that God has given to him. So let's read these, just a smaller portion. I am asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. The glory you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may be completely one. And you see my title here, The Kingdom of God. And that's that first top image I've given you as well, The Kingdom of God. That's not what we usually, that's not the phrase we usually hear, is it? Normally we would hear the kingdom of God. We're very familiar with that. But today I want to talk about the kingdom of God. Who are your kin? Who are your kinfolk? Even using the word kinfolk, you may feel like I've dropped you into an old episode of the Beverly Hillbillies. Come and listen to my story about a man named
Jed.
A poor mountaineer, barely
kept his family fed.
So family is kinfolk. And today I want to talk about the duty, the responsibility of the heads of family to keep the family fed, to produce prosperity, opportunities for prosperity, and to provide protection, to keep the family safe, to keep the family secure. I'm sure some of us have this summer that's now ending on October the 1st. Don't you love this fall weather we had this past week? But I'm sure that some of you over the summer have had family reunions. I've seen several of your Facebook posts of family gatherings as you stretch the nets as far as possible to gather in your kinfolk, whether that be at the house or the lake or the beach or the restaurant, wherever it may be. And using the word kin, we are in the realm of family, aren't we? Now, did I just say realm? The word realm itself is kingdom-oriented, right? So perhaps this idea of kingdom and kingdom aren't really that so far apart after all. Both are realms, and both feel the charge not only to keep the family fed, to provide opportunities for prosperity, but also to protect the territory, to defend the turf, if you would, the territory, to keep safe those who are in the family. And that's true whether it's a large government entity, a superpower in our time, such as the United States of America, or whether it's a simple tribal clan in the ancient world of Israel, one of the 12 tribes. That's true of Jesus in his high priestly prayer as he goes to the cross. I have finished the work. I've provided for their eternal salvation, and I am praying to protect them, that they would gather together as one now and in all eternity. Any human government, whether a monarchy, a kingdom, or a democratic republic, governments are charged with the defense of the realm, keeping safe and secure their entire domain. Now, there's another kingdom-oriented word, domain. As with governments, it's very natural to speak of the family domain, right? A man's home is his castle, is a phrase you may have heard. That's a simplified statement of a statement that was made in 1604 by Sir Edward Coke, and he famously said this: the house of everyone is to him as his castle and fortress, as well for defense against injury and violence as for his repose. In other words, both prosperity, safety, and security. But as for oneness, that's what Jesus is praying for so eloquently. Now, that's more difficult to achieve. than prosperity and protection. In what family do all the family members think alike with uniformity? Does yours? As the realm grows, whether the realm of a country or whether the realm of a family, diversity ensues. Differences emerge. Deliberative bodies within government disagree and bicker and argue. You think? Have you been watching the news? And you know, in family relationships, there's some bickering and arguing sometimes as well. But we are still akin. Akin. Now, there's an interesting word. A-K-I-N. Akin. There's something that makes us alike. Whether as Christians we are alike, or as Americans we are alike, or in your larger family structures of brothers and sisters and aunts and uncles, beneath all of our differences, there is something we share, something in which we are akin. We are like one another. Each of us lives within multiple circles of kinship. All of us, for example, every living person is part of the largest of those families. That is the human family created by God. Homo sapiens. We are all kin in a very real way in our genetic makeup, the human genome. The human family, though, is scattered and diverse, divided into peoples and cultures and countries, nations, where kinship is experienced in ever smaller circles, all the way down to family clans and the individual family unit. We are American, we are Russian, Chinese, French, German, on and on we might go. The Bible recognizes national structure. Genesis chapter 10 is a chapter that's often called the Table of Nations, as it speaks of the nations broadening out, describing the dispersion of the global family into smaller families of nations. Citizens of the United States of America are, despite our differences, akin in the sense that we share the rights of every citizen. Keep the family fed in the sense of providing opportunities for prosperity and to be safe and secure. As citizens, we each, no matter our differences, own rights that are unique to us as citizens. And perhaps that's the baseline for understanding a little of what Jesus meant in this prayer when he said, "I pray not for the world, but for those that you have given me, that they may be one." They, that is, who have been introduced to Jesus as the Son of God sent to redeem his church, those who in repentance and faith have trusted Jesus as their Savior and Lord. World Communion Sunday acknowledges and celebrates the kinship, the kingdom of these persons, not of the entire world, but of all believers, those who have called upon the name of Jesus Christ, trusting in his victory over death through the resurrection, for their eternal hope of salvation. This, across all cultures, across all countries, is the Christian family. It's what Jesus said in the Great Commission. Go into all the nations. He didn't say erase all the nations. He said go into all the nations and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And we are ever seeking to widen the family embrace. And that's called evangelism, and that's good news. What is it the choir kept singing? And there is room for everyone. Anyone who by repentance and faith will come to Jesus Christ, welcome into this wonderful family. This is the good news of the gospel. I remember the times when Mom, when she was alive, and her three boys, all three, I'm the middle one, all three of us in Pine Bluff at once would be there and maybe take them out from Trinity Village to a restaurant around the table. And it's hard to forget how Mom, with face just glowing with joy, would say to Dad, "Daddy, look, all three of our boys are here around the table at one time." Dad was a little less enthusiastic about it, at least outwardly. And if our whole family was together on those many occasions where spouses and grandkids and great-grandkids were all present, then all the more joy. Everybody's together. We're all around the table. We are one. And on World Communion Sunday, as we gather with God's family around the communion table, in spirit with folks who on the name of Jesus Christ in every corner of the globe. There are so many differences, so many, but our commonality is our belief in a God who loved us through Jesus Christ, who the Word became flesh to dwell among us and to die upon the cross for our salvation. And today on World Communion Sunday, we're all together, and you can imagine the joy on God's face to say you're all here and you're all welcome at this table. What we do today at World Communion Sunday is a foretaste of God's future kingdom. And we pray that every time. Well, in our service, we sing it right at the end of every service here. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That day is not yet. But today we are going to gather in spirit nonetheless. Today, God's kingdom is God's kingdom. And we are one as a family of Christ. And listen, listen, the miracle, the real miracle is that it's God's kingdom too. That's the glory of the divine plan, that God became flesh in Jesus Christ, like us, akin to us. A baby in a manger, a man who hungered and thirsted and grew weary and knew sadness and pain and wept and so much pain, a man who bled and died, as this table reminds us with its bread and wine, the body and blood of Jesus. Jesus became our kin. So as we gather on World Communion Sunday, we gather in unity. But listen, though we gather in unity, that doesn't necessarily mean we gather in uniformity of thought. What? Our unity is not based on uniformity. Different denominations have splintered throughout history. Many have been the disagreements, and that splintering still going on and always will. But there is more that unites us. World Communion Sunday reminds us of this, that our fellowship around this table is not based on uniformity of thought about all matters concerning faith, except on the basic matter of Jesus Christ being our salvation. Same thing in the realm of national life. Our unity as Americans is not based on uniformity of thought, but we are kin, nonetheless, as Americans, despite not always being akin in our thoughts and opinions. But this much should be a given, else our identity is at risk. That we do have a national domain, and it must be defended, something obvious in the Constitution, and so commonsensical as to be a basic fact of family that's acknowledged by all nations with or without a constitution. Our nation, indeed, nations throughout the Western world, particularly in Europe, is struggling with this challenge of understanding our own borders. What shall we say of nations and borders? Does the very idea of World Communion Sunday have anything to say about that? Does the very idea of World Communion Sunday imply that borders should be erased? Just as we say with the Christian family? I think not at all. Our opening hymn, and verse 2 of our opening hymn has always been one of my favorites of our entire hymnal. Elect, that is God's chosen, elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth. Her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth. One holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food, and to one hope she presses, with every grace endued. That is one of the most solidly theological verses in all of Christian hymnody, that our unity, our oneness, is not based on uniformity of our national identity. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth. In our sanctuary are two flags. I don't know how many of you noticed that when you come in. Our identity and unity as Christians is indicated by the Christian flag you see there with the cross on top, a spiritual kingdom. Our identity and unity as Americans is indicated by the stars and stripes, our national flag with the eagle on top. I've known some pastors who see that flag in any sanctuary as unnecessary and frankly bordering on offensive, that we would have a national flag in a Christian sanctuary. And I get their emphasis that as Christians, our unity is a spiritual kingdom and a spiritual kingdom. But I disagree that our national flag is at all out of place, because we have a national kingdom as well. And our faith as Christians, if it is alive and vibrant, should help shape our nation as well. As in every nation, those of the Christian family, meaning those who share Judeo-Christian ethics and values derived from the Bible, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, should have a voice and influence in whatever nation they may be citizens of, so that that flag can fly with different national flags wherever in the globe they may be. And that flag should influence the policies and the thoughts of any national flag to stand for the things that Judeo-Christian ethics stands for: justice and compassion. So the world communion of the Christian flag can help shape the fragmented world in which we live, with all the many national flags, so that all the nations can work together for peace and prosperity and security for their citizens. I want to close with a story from Kentucky. We have any Kentucky football fans here? Probably not. I hear of all those other schools, but rarely of Kentucky. But boy, if there's a Kentucky fan here, they're on cloud nine today. But before God invented football, before God invented football in Kentucky especially, but in other areas of our country, on Sunday afternoon, the entertainment was very often theological debates. And Kentucky churches would fill up in the afternoon with people from all over the community to hear the pastors and leaders of all their churches in the community, Methodist, Baptist, Presbyterian, Church of Christ, on and Episcopal, on and on, to hear strongly opinionated pastors go after each other like dogs and cats. It was like a line of scrimmage on issues like virgin birth, infant baptism, predestination, when Jesus will return, and it got heated. It got heated. That was the sport of the day in the 19th century. But at the end of every debate, those pastors had a ritual. They would lock arms, they would approach the communion table, and they would kneel together at the chancel to signify that something deeper united them than the theological opinions that divided them. Their unity was not based on uniformity, nor should ours be. So on this World Communion Sunday, let us lock arms with each other in spirit, and not only with each other within these walls, but with each other around the world. And people of faith in Jesus Christ on every continent and within every national border, let us come to this table as God's kingdom and imagine how God smiles as His children, despite their differences, are today one. In the name of the Father, and Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As we come to this table on World Communion Sunday, let us remember that night on which Jesus was betrayed, how He gathered with His disciples in the upper room it was Passover, and to have the Passover meal, and to veer away from the traditional ritual of that meal that goes all the way back 1,000 years before Jesus, more than 1,000 years before Jesus slightly, all the way to the Exodus of Moses. And that meal had held the family together of the Jewish people. But He veered into a different direction when He took the bread. He offered the same thanks, but then He broke the bread, and giving it to His disciples, He said something that might seem very strange as kingdom. He said, "This is my body, This is my body which is given for you. Take it and eat it. And do it as long until I come again. And then he took the cup, the Elijah cup it was called, and he gave thanks. And he gave it to the disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins. And Jesus meant, maybe his disciples didn't know it at the time, not the blood of bulls and goats and animal sacrifices in the temple just across the way, but he meant his own blood. This is my blood that will be shed for you. And they didn't know how soon it would be. Tomorrow. I'll be arrested tonight in the Garden of Gethsemane. My blood will be poured out for you tomorrow. And drink from this as often as you drink it until I come again. Holy God, make us one. We are all different in so many ways. Make us one around this table, not only as we gather here in this sanctuary, but with Christians around the globe who today celebrate World Communion Sunday. Amen. All right, I'm going to ask our servers to come first. And we've been serving communion in this way since we've come back and began serving communion again since COVID. And I know that most of you will know exactly what to do. If you're a guest here, you just follow the path, okay? We're going to have four stations and serve by intinction. Intinction means you'll take a wafer and you'll dip it into the chalice and then receive it. If you'd rather not do that, we have the individual package. You can still come up for a blessing and receive it and take it back, and you'll see how to open this. It has both the wafer and the juice in it, and we'd be happy to serve you communion in that way as well. Don't get in a hurry. We have four stations. We'll have stations first to serve the front and the back. You'll have two in the back of the Mark and Luke sections, and then we'll go out to our Matthew and John sections. All right. Am I forgetting anything? All right. Yes, sir. And that is, if you don't feel mobile enough to come to one of these stations, just stay right where you are. And at the end, I'll ask you, you raise your hand, and we will bring the elements right to you, okay? Thank you. Are there any now to whom we need to bring the elements in the pews? Did we see them all, or are there more? Joy it is to gather around this table and in spirit to lock arms with the people of Christ all around the globe. Let us pray with thanksgiving. Holy God, today we feel that our faith goes beyond these walls, beyond our congregation, so that we embrace congregations and people who call themselves by the name of Jesus around this world. And we are one, entrusting our eternal salvation to your love as expressed in Jesus Christ our Lord and to his victory over the grave. We give you thanks. Amen.
Amen.
All right, our closing hymn will be number 620, One Bread, One Body. And I invite you now to turn there and let's stand together as we sing that hymn.
One in the Lord.
body, one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless, and we know many throughout the earth. We are one body in this one Lord. Grain for the fields, scattered and grown, gathered to one for all, one bread, one body, one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless, and we know many throughout the earth. We are one body in this one Lord.
Thank you for joining us as we worship on this World Communion Sunday. Gail, we love you and we pray for you as you go to your new home and with your family. And Jeannie, thank you so much for your service to Christ of the Hills United Methodist Church. Would you receive this benediction, and after that, would you join us in coffee fellowship in our fellowship hall? And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be yours now and always. Amen.
Amen. Now let us join hands as we sing the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.